Schools in all these communities canceled. Some schools were being used as shelters for residents. Lawrence resident Bruce Raisin was among the evacuees standing outside the the Colonel Heights neighborhood, which is near the city's high school, trying to decide what he was going to do. Said officials had cut the power to the area and the streets were pitch black, save for emergency vehicle lights. Raisin said he arrived just as residents were being evacuated and immediately saw the house and two doors down was leveled from an explosion. He says, I couldn't imagine if that was my house. Raisin, who purchased his house nearly 2 years ago, it's total destruction. I'd be completely devastated. With a backpack filled with personal items he had hastily grabbed, said he'd head to his mother's house just a few towns over for the night. This is what people are experiencing, folks. In Massachusetts, where yesterday they said it looked like Armageddon, just 39 explosions after explosion after explosion. Columbia had announced earlier yesterday that it would be upgrading gas lines in neighborhoods across the state, including the area where the explosions happened. But it wasn't clear whether work was happening there, and a spokeswoman did not return any phone calls, according to CBS News. Definitely a scary situation, folks, there, and we don't know if it was terrorism, don't know if it was faulty gas lines, old gas lines. And there's a lot of bad infrastructure in our country, like our power grid, but gas, can you imagine? We don't have a lot of gas infrastructure here in the Tampa Bay area. Some areas have it, but largely speaking, not. It's one thing I liked when I worked in Northern California for a time. We had gas, baby. Well, we heated our house and you cooked on gas. And it's just so much more efficient. I liked it. I enjoyed it, but you got to make sure that pilot light's going, baby. And in the Northeast, our heat was gas. In Newton, New Jersey, where my mother still lives, most stuff, you got the pilot light going for the water heater, and there you go. Yeah, there was gas dryers as well. But you got to make sure that pilot light was going. Luckily, most of those utilities have alarms to alert you that you have a gas leak. And luckily, a lot of people were contacted to be able to get out of Dodge before their house exploded. So there were alerts, phone calls, emails, all sorts of things coming out from Duke Energy to warn people, to alert people to get the heck out of there. But that was big doings, folks, and still big doings if you didn't hear that big story up there in Massachusetts. Series of gas explosions, if you're just joining us. In Massachusetts, 39 homes exploded. Columbia Gas in Lawrence, Andover, North Andover to evacuate. We're evacuating, but the governor and mayor and several mayors trying to find out exactly what happened and why. And I'm sure we'll have some answers here, but more people could have died from this. We just have a teenager that passed away. It's just a miracle, I think, that more people weren't killed. And it could have been the case. 39 homes, folks, just one young man passed away. That's pretty big. You couldn't plan it any other way. I am just leaning more towards, you know, I have some folks saying, hey, this was terrorism, you know, it would be a great way. But I'm guessing that this was something to do. And given the fact and the irony, on the same day that they announced the gas utility that they were going to be making upgrades, that they already knew that there was problems with the system, and then that happened. All I can tell you is because of that knowledge in the investigation, those 39 homes, I guarantee you there's going to be some kind of mutual lawsuit against the utility, okay, to rebuild those houses, and it's going to cost them pretty dearly. And yeah, everything's going to have to be upgraded, everything. I would imagine people were going to be without gas much longer. And would you trust it after that to turn your gas on after that many explosions? I would be erecting some kind of charcoal grill, going to the local restaurant or doing Uber Eats or something like that. But definitely wouldn't. But this splashed up on my phone yesterday, and I was like, I couldn't believe it. I'm like, what in the world? I remember back in 2011, there was a natural gas explosion that killed several people in Allentown, Pennsylvania. And that was a pretty bad one. Yeah. And there was one out in California, I remember, at Pacific Gas. There was a pipeline that exploded in San Bernardino, or is it San Bruno, California, but that killed about 8 people. And that destroyed 38 homes. So 39 in Massachusetts, 38 in California for history there. Wow. Pretty scary, folks. But again, the loss of life could have been a whole lot more severe. There were people that were injured, at least 10 other people, and ignited fires about 39 homes. So one dead, 10 injured. The number could go up. But the gentleman that lost his life, Mr. Rodden, he was 18, of Lawrence, and he died again because the chimney toppled over by the explosion and then crashed into his car and killed him. So God bless him. A pretty cool story, kind of switch it up a little bit, a little levity here. You never know what to expect on a Friday, especially at For the People. We like stories like this. Were you a fan of Roy Orbison? He has so many great songs, right? Well, his son was crying the other day because he saw his dad in a hologram. Yeah, a hologram. Roy Orbison is actually going to be going back on tour nearly 30 years after his passing. Roy Orbison, the iconic rock and roll, you know, the guy, he was a crooner who provided the title of inspiration for the 1990s Pretty Woman, starring Julia Roberts, Richard Gere. You remember that. It's hard to believe, though. Roy's been gone since 1988. Remember the Traveling Wilburys? Oh, it was just terrific. Yeah, we're going to play one of his songs. He died at 52 from a heart attack back in 88. So now, this beloved 60s singer being resurrected to hit the road once more through the magic of a hologram. This hologram technology is so lifelike, folks. The estate approved the hologram tour to kick off in Europe early this year, and next month will begin a 28-date run across the U.S. and Canada. I'm not even kidding. So if you're a Roy Orbison fan, make sure you go to Roy Orbison's website. And there's so many songs we could play. We're going to play You Got It. And this is from 1989, which is one of my favorites. But if you're looking to buy a ticket, you better bet you'll be crying like Roy's son, who said it was so lifelike and people were so emotional during the concert, he knew that he had to resurrect his dad. And that's a great way to do it. Alex Orbison cried when the image of his father performing on stage. And again, nearly 30 years after his passing, it's amazing what you can do with technology, isn't it? You got it. And by request, because Alex said he wanted to hear from Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Every time I look into your loving eyes, I see love that money just can't buy.
Everything about you tells me I'm your man. I live
Roy Orbison, you got it on For the People and a hologram concert coming to you somewhere in the United States. You're going to have to go to royorbison.com to find out. And I said, what, 1989? That's when they released it here on iTunes. Apparently you got it, but it came out in the early 80s with the Traveling Wilburys and was a great song, but so many great songs. Oh, Pretty Woman, Crying, Only the Lonely, Blue Bayou. I mean, there's just so many great songs, so many great memories. And, you know, like they say, music's like the soundtrack to your life, literally, can just kind of take you back to those places. I mean, when that song came out in the 80s, I mean, I just remember things that were going on. It just kind of, and it takes you exactly back there. So I couldn't imagine for, you know, real big fans of Roy Orbison to see him in a hologram. And again, it's so lifelike. They wouldn't do it unless it really looked like Roy was on the stage. I mean, it's that good. So I would imagine they were thinking about doing that. And, you know, come on, the Jacksons, they have Michael Jackson tour. So can you imagine Frank Sinatra? How about Elvis tours? I'm sure this will be something of the future. I mean, you see this in movies. But this stuff is happening, and the technology, again, is that great. And they'll have live orchestration right there on the stage next to him. So it really looks like, for real, that he's there interacting with the band, the orchestra, et cetera. I mean, that's just, to me, unbelievably. I don't know. Some people think it's a little creepy. What do you think about it? A little weird. Weigh in at For the People Show on Facebook or ForThePeopleShow.com. Let me know what you think. And I love to share your thoughts, read your thoughts. I'd like to know what you're thinking in regards to that. It's a little creepy, I think so. But again, if you're a fan, love the music, and especially if somebody never experienced Elvis. I have met so many Elvis lovers, and I was born in 1970, okay? And, you know, I heard Elvis growing up, and then I heard about his death, what, in 77? So, but I didn't, you know, really... I didn't get into it. I was listening to Eddie Money and John Cougar Mellencamp, 38 Special, Van Halen, listening to Casey's Countdown, that kind of thing. So it wasn't huge, but in Memphis, when I was working for Bot Radio Network for many years there, there was Tunica, Mississippi, okay? And people knew Elvis. There were stories in Memphis about him, and you know, people that grew up with him, it could tell stories. But I met a girl that worked at the casino over at Sam's Town Hotel and Gambling Hall, and she loved